I'm not interested in proving myself one bit. I'm interested in trying to learn.
Hello, everyone. Today, we're hosting Fatima Ad-Dar'i, who is the newest member of the external communications team under our corporate communications department. In addition to being a proud cat mother of a 5-year-old cat, called Farhan, she loves cooking, reading, dancing, and everything related to culture. She's a Takatuf scholar who studied international relations and English literature in Richmond, Virginia, where she developed quite an obsession with early 19th century American literature. So, if you want to discuss anything about this period of literature and culture, you know who to find. Welcome, Fatima.
Hi, thank you for the nice introduction.
You're welcome. I loved giving the introduction, especially about you being a mother of a 5-year-old cat, because as soon as I saw it, wow. So Farhan, Joy, I believe his name is.
Yeah, he came to me with the name Joy, and I wanted to give him an Arabic name, so it became Joy Farhan.
Okay.
And it works out really well, because he's a very happy cat.
So the name is, it brings out your culture, it brings out, it's kind of Farhan, it's very Omani, it's very traditional. Why did you name him Joy or Farhan?
Well, like I said, he came to me with the name Joy, because I adopted him after I moved to Muscat for work. But I really wanted to give him an Arabic name. And as you mentioned, I'm an international student and I've studied in the US. And during my time there, just sort of making sure that our culture is always at the forefront, but also adapting other cultures is not necessarily opposite, but they can come together. So it doesn't have to be just English. It doesn't have to be just Arabic. Why not have them both? Because they both work. And, you know, I'm Omani. I was born and raised here, but I studied also in the US for a really long time. And I consider it also my home. So Oman is home, US is home, neither is home without the other. So of course my cat is gonna have a, like, you know, an Arabic and an English name.
No, absolutely. It's always fun to have a cat. It's always fun to have a pet. And I hope he brings you a lot of joy, let's say that. So talking about culture, and you studied in the US, you were a Takatuf scholar. Tell us about how you were raised in the culture that kind of brought you up into this person that you become right now.
So it's really interesting, because I always tell people, like, I've been, you know, like many other people my age, we've been parented by culture, whether it's, you know, via the media, through TV or just internet. But growing up, I was very, very much obsessed with, again, any medium of culture, whether that be shows, books, music. And I would take them like very seriously, and I would try to, you know, imitate them, pretend like I'm speaking to characters on the TV and such. So really my English and the and kind of like the accent that I have came from that. But also so much of the coded American culture and its norms kind of came from these mediums too. Whether they were truly represented or not is one thing, but I got them from there. So, you know, I went through the motions of growing up here and went through school. And in high school, when I applied for the scholarship, the program and its structure was that we had to go to boarding school for 2 years and then go to college. Yeah, because the idea was for us to prepare, and also, like, you know, during boarding school for college. And we had to do the standardized testing and apply, like, a lot of, you know, the, I guess, the regular pool of applicants of international students. Because the process is slightly different in Oman through the Qubul al-Muwahhad. So I, you know, I thought it was interesting. I always wanted to, like, you know, go to boarding school. I was very much infantilized by the Harry Potter series. I was like, cool, I can do my boarding school. Sure, there's no magic, but it's the closest thing to it, right?
Actually, yes. Speaking to you and looking at you right now, you're wearing a shirt that says Washington, D.C. And
I was
like, yes. that's speaks a lot of culture to me. That is culture itself. And talking about culture, discussing culture, culture is very important in the workplace. I feel like it's part of us. It helps us accommodate with the daily routine of our job, and it helps us shape our understanding with people, how we talk. And please tell us how you adapt yourself in a department such as the corporate communications department.
Yeah, so to this question, there's like multiple levels, because we can start at a really high level. When we say OQ, it's an international company. It's not just based in Oman. It has you know, locations abroad. Mm-hmm. So this idea of being like an international company, but Oman is dealing and interacting with international people, very much fits the theme of sort of my life so far. You know, I've been Omani, I've been dealing with international people, and then you know, going to boarding school and college was very much a part of it too. Mm-hmm. So on one level, it's sort of bringing a lot of the communication skill set of understanding sometimes what do people say and what do they mean by what they say, because sometimes we can use the same exact words and the same verbs and nouns, but we have cultural weights to them that mean different things. You know, so it's kind of like aubergine versus eggplants, you know, these sort of really funny, but very interesting cultural codes.
Yeah.
And I think in OQ, we have to be very mindful of that, because we're Omanis in a very international sort of a spotlight.
Yeah, society. Yeah.
So, and then we're scaling it down to sort of like, you know, super micro level. And we're talking about our specific department, the communications department in Muscat, you know. I'm in the external communications department, so it's sort of like similar to yours at internal. It keeps us at our toes. It's a lot of dynamic things, and it's a lot of trying to coordinate but also create content and aligning content and all of that. So not only are you creating communication content, you're trying to communicate with other people about it, to get it or to deliver it. So the culture of how that's being done, we need to talk a lot. We send, you know, we write a lot, we talk a lot, and that requires sort of being comfortable with the people that you're around. A little bit of understanding and compassion goes a long way in our department.
Absolutely. Compassion goes a long way. And I feel like we need that support from our teammates, from our team members. And we need it. We need it for our well-being. We need it to do our job better. So for you, starting off your career at OQ, this is a very important stage of your life. Please tell us about it.
So I am very much I like thinking that I'm an independent person. I do a lot of things on my own. And like I mentioned earlier, I moved to Muscat on my own. I'm kind of like, you know, going through the motions of life, sort of like as a, you know, young adult during the subnormal time. On my own, but I am very much also a community person, and that's something that's extended and has proved to be super magical and wonderful during my time abroad, because they're sort of like having this structure of non-traditional family was very much the core of what shaped my experience, the core of what made me decide a lot of decisions. So coming here to OQ, I knew that, you know, the first thing I wanted was like, okay, a team that I like but is also just a little bit more extroverted, a little bit more that can be that group for me too. And they've supported me a lot outside of work. Just like, you know, I don't have a car yet. And, you know, people have been very nice about dropping me, driving me whenever I needed to. But sort of when we're talking about, this is kind of like more on the personal life aspect, but on a professional level, like I mentioned earlier, as young, as new people, we're just making a lot of mistakes. And I think there's just a, they give me the space to be open about the mistakes that I made without necessarily, you know, having wing or being faced, like, you know, waved at me, being like, oh my God, you screwed up big time. It's more so, okay, let's take this as a lesson learned. And I think that's really paramount, because you mentioned this idea, or I mentioned it, like, you know, this idea that you need to prove yourself and whatnot. And I'm not interested in proving myself one bit. I'm interested in trying to learn and just building a relationship with people, like really meaningful relationships.
Connecting with people,
absolutely. Whether it's like by working together or just like doing things on a personal level. And I think I've been very, very fortunate with the people that I have in my team, because they've been those people.
And it draws back to the culture of the people, the culture of connecting, understanding, compassion. This is the part of living, part of developing yourself. It's becoming a new society. I want to revert back to your living abroad and tell us, I know you have a funny story about living abroad. Can you please tell us about it?
Oh yeah, there's so many stories. But just kind of like tying it to the idea of like community again. When I had to get my wisdom teeth removed, it was my third year of college. You know, they're starting to hurt. I went to see like a dental a professional, and they were like, okay, you just need to extract them. Mm-hmm. So when I went for the consultation, they said, okay, someone needs to take care of you. Like, you'll be out for the entire day. And that was such a vulnerable moment for me. I never felt so defeated during my entire abroad experience. I'm like, what? Someone else has to take care of me? Mm-hmm. And especially because when you're abroad and you're living on your own, just being having...
You always want to be dependent.
Yeah, but also like in full control. Even if the world is falling apart around me, okay, at least I have control over my own body, you know? But definitely I would want to be independent and just have control of the situation. But, you know, my friend had to basically take care of me that day. So after the surgery, I was drenched from head to toe. I couldn't move a single muscle. And my friend I couldn't even walk. Like, I would fall. Yeah. And I had to have, like, two people support me to even get to the car and then get me out of the car when my friend finally drove me back to campus. And I had this, like, bloody gauze in my mouth because, you know, they just kind of, like, pulled out the teeth and it's, like, super bloody and you have all the gauze. And the doctor told my friend that someone had to change it when I got there. My friend thought that at least I'll be conscious enough to change it myself, but I'm still like really heavily drugged and I couldn't move at all. So she had to put her hand inside my bloody mouth and just like hold my jaw open even. I couldn't open my jaw and just like change the gauze like in the middle of the bathroom of like her dorm building. And, you know, she took me to her room with the help of another person. I stayed in her bed and then someone went to grab me like a smoothie or something. And, you know, there was like a little group study that happened in the room just to kind of like, okay, we all have eyes on Fatima for the day. And, you know, I'm super, super grateful for people like that because once you cross that line, you're like family, you know?
Absolutely.
That's something like that your family would do. And it's one of those things where I never felt unsupported or that I was gonna like, you know, socially fall through because I've had community like that.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's one of many stories of sort of like funny things that happened and just losing control over things.
Yeah, that's a great story. And talking about financial stability, it's always nice to have that in the control, being able to balance your income, balance your expenditure. And that revolves around your way of living. And I want to talk about the stability of being at work. I want to talk about your aspirations, your career path. Where do you see yourself? What inspires you?
I'm too fickle for this question. I think people should stop asking young people these questions. We're trying to live through the day, let alone think of the future so far ahead, you know? Because again, like going to the financial stability thing, it's really important to ask yourself, are the inspirations that you want to get, can they be supported or can they not be supported financially? Would you need to compensate for them or do you have someone to help you? And it's okay to ask these questions as long as you're realistic about them. Because I would see this a lot where people rely on the fact their families might be able to support them. Lo and behold, they can't. Why? Just because someone else's family supported them. There's no right or wrong way about it, as much as like you need to be very precise and like ask honest questions. But for now, you know, I love 19th century American literature.
Okay.
I love talking about it. I love discussing it. I love thinking about how it translates into action. So as long as I get to work with that, I'm really, you know, I'll be happy, whether it means working, you know, in a cultural center or joining academia later on. So much of that literature is really interesting as a model of knowledge.
Great. Fatima, this has been a pleasure. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for joining us. It's been inspirational just talking to you. I feel like we learned a lot from just listening to you talk, discuss culture, discuss your passion. This has been very interesting. Any final words?
Yeah, I think sometimes it's really important to be creative about the way that we think sometimes of our skill sets. Because, you know, I studied English literature, but we were like, oh, then how did you end up like, you know, in this kind of field? I'm like, well, transferable skills. I have the skills and I just transferred them to another kind of situation. So I encourage everyone to think very flexibly of their skills and how they can transfer into different departments, even if it was nothing you ever studied. Other than that, you know, keep being you, take care of yourself and look out for your community.
Yeah, I feel like that's a great message. Being able to be yourself, inspire others, reflect back in your community. That speaks OQ to me. Share, care and dare. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining our podcast. This has been your host, Muhammad Al-Busaidi. Have a great day.